After I got out of the military, I was invited to a church. I'm trying to break it a little shorter than what I usually do. We were invited to a church for a healing service. And I didn't really want to go, but I kept complaining to my mother, that's not a church, that's a dog pound. And nobody would believe me. But sure enough, when we went, there was a little white church that had three or four steps on it, a wooden church, wooden floors. But I sat at the very back of the pew because I was getting ready to run. Because I didn't want to be there. Well, when you're not saved and you don't know God, things are just kind of weird, you know? Oh, we all know that, right? It's weird. But some things entice you just a little bit. And begin to hear this woman begin to speak, and I don't remember what she said. I wasn't paying no attention. That's how us sinners are. We don't pay attention. I'm not a sinner, of course, but when I was sinning, I didn't pay attention to nothing. But when she started calling people up for healing, my sister and both my sisters were healed, but they called me, not by name, but the disease that people have, it's epileptic seizures, which is the grandma seizures, the one I had, which is the worst kind you can have. It has something to do with the brain, but anyway, I never further into all that there, but I'm glad God healed me. But I didn't want to go. I really wanted to go out the door, even though something pushed me out loud. But they pushed me all the way to the front. Now, that's God. But I didn't know it then. But when I got home, I tried to take my medicine like normal, and I couldn't. I get my hand this far, and I couldn't put it in my mouth. It just wouldn't let me. So I flushed them down the toilet. The following week, we went back to see that church. There was nothing there but dog pound. That's supernatural.
Amen.
I didn't realize that until he said something. I just know it was gone. I didn't understand it. Even after I got saved, I still didn't understand it. But I do understand it now. The more you read the Bible, the more you pray, the more you study, the more you seek God, the more you understand things. But I went back to have my test run, EEG, brainwave test, and I've never had a seizure. All scarring is gone.
Hallelujah.
Yes. Hallelujah.
Yes. God heals people completely, not just a little bit. Say, right. It'll be all right for a while. But God says always completely healed.
Amen.
I like that.
Yes.
But my dream that I had, and I know I'm jumping from one place to the next, but the dream I had Thursday, I'll think about Thursday, the girl got saved. Tuesday of last week, I dreamed that we were already traveling on our journey to Colorado. I remember us pulling something. I'm not sure if it was a car or what it was. But there was two churches, one on this side and one on this side. And for some reason or we knew the people on this church here. And I know God puts you in places that you don't quite understand why you're there. But I said, I don't belong in this church. I belong across the street. And they said, yes, you do. My wife asked for a tablet book, and I remember the little red tablet book. I always carry the work, and I give it to her to write all these names down that we're praying for. And I went to the church, and everybody said, we're waiting on you because you've got to pray for all these people up here. Well, I don't remember praying for all these people but one person. She was blind, and she was deaf since birth. The blindness was cataract so bad she couldn't see. But the lady that was with her began to tell me about her being deaf since she was born. So they do sign language in a hand. And I don't know if anybody knows how to do sign language in a hand or not. It's just alphabets. The feeling of alphabets in your hand. And it's just words. You can't do a whole complete sentence. It's just a little bit of understanding. So I began to pray for her. I started to put my fingers in her. Both her ears, and electricity went into her ears, and she began immediately to hear. But she still couldn't see. I hadn't prayed for her yet, for her eyes. And I don't know why I did both separate, but I did. It had to be God. And so people are still steadily coming in to this big church, a pretty sized church. It probably holds a couple hundred people. at least. And I began to pray for her eyes. When I moved her hand, my hand, she said, I still can't see. So I immediately turned around and I said, who in here does not believe? One man raised her hand. I said, get out. Now we know Jesus said it to the unbelievers, but Peter is paying attention. I learned that from the pastor. That he told the same thing. If you don't believe, get out. Amen. Because the unbelief will stop. God's showing all of us what we need to do, even with dreams, visions, and reality.
Yeah.
You know, the pastor's had dreams. I've had dreams. I've had lots of dreams. But I can't share all of them because I don't have time.
Amen.
But knowing that you can praise God and touch the ceiling.
Yes.
Even though the ceiling is only this high. But there's purposes for everything. I don't always understand it all until you get there.
That's right.
You have to be there. Praise God. I love the Lord.
Amen. Amen.
Praise the Lord.
For those that don't know, those seizures was 35, almost 40 years ago.
Yeah.
He's not had one since.
Praise God.
Isn't that awesome?
Yeah.
I wanted him to share that because he preached one Sunday night and this lady was calling out everything that your two sisters had, right?
The one had nephritis, which is back years ago was a deadly disease. Incurable.
Incurable.
And then they started getting a little medication, but it wasn't much. It's a blood disease in the urine,
mm-hmm.
in the kidneys. And God cured her. My middle sister needed a new kidney.
A new kidney?
A new kidney. And even the doctors were amazed that the new one was better than the old one.
Now, let me get this straight. When the lady was preaching, she was calling by the word of knowledge what was wrong, right?
Right. Now, this is the problems, the infirmities.
She was just calling the infirmities.
Right.
The sickness,
right.
The disease. And did your mama get anything out of that?
Just my sisters and myself.
And he went back to that church, and it was not a church, it was a dog pound.
Amen.
God is a supernatural God. If he can't find someone to flow through here, he'll send heaven to earth.
Yeah.
Glory to God. Hallelujah.
That's a powerful testimony.
Yes, it is.
You got healed in heaven's church. Glory to God. Hallelujah. But I wanted him to share that is because I want every one of us to believe in here.
Yeah.
If you begin to doubt one day, you know, Jesus had to take someone out of the city one day.
Yes, amen.
Don't doubt. Believe a believer. God has a miracle for you.
Amen.
But if you doubt, oh Lord, praise God, that just shot up like an arrow. If you doubt, you cancel out your miracle.
That's right. Amen.
You cancel it out.
Yeah, glory.
I'm not a doubter, I'm a believer.
Amen.
Russell, I'm a believer.
Amen.
You're a believer.
Amen.
Glory to God. We're all believers. Let's believe the truth and not a lie. Let's believe God, TJ, and not Satan. Amen. The Bible says, let God be true and let every man be a liar.
Amen.
Let's don't believe the flesh, let's believe God.
Amen.
Amen. Praise the Lord. Anybody got anything else to add?
Can I share the testimony that I had for Thursday?
Sure, go ahead.
A girl is in my work, and I can't remember her name. I can't remember her name. The names are unusual for me. I can't hardly pronounce them sometimes. But she and the lady in the
Beauty shop,
thank you. We're talking about the Bible, and they were praying for somebody to stop by and talk to them. Well, I didn't know I was supposed to come by there, but God put you in a place where you need to be at. Am I right? You agree with that, right? And they called me in there, and the lady said her daughter was having bad nightmares and seeing monsters on the head of her bed because she'd look at them, and they had little red beady eyes. And I began to explain to her, that's not monsters, that's demons. Their room is possessed with demons, not the flesh, but the room was. And I began to minister to her, and she said, yeah, she does a lot of profanity talking, 2-year-old. I said, where does she get that from? She says, from me. But children mimic what parents do.
Amen.
And I said, that's got to stop. I said, now, if you was to die tonight, do you know where you'd go? And she's always thought she was saved. But when I brung all that out there, she says, I don't know. And if you don't know, you're not saved.
Right.
And I began to speak to her about salvation. Do you want to know where you want to go? She said, yeah. I said, let's pray. And I began to pray with her and let her confess that she was a sinner. And ask God into her heart. You know, a glow come on her face immediately.
Yes.
Changed her life. She went home and she prayed with her children. She read the Bible with her children. And they had a better night. Awesome. Yeah. And I'll come back to work the next day. And she had to tell me all about it.
Amen.
Hallelujah. So
I didn't save her, but I led her to the Lord.
Amen.
We all got to lead people to the Lord. I'm ready to preach. Praise the Lord. We'll get us back to the pastor now.
Will see if anybody else has a testimony.
Somebody else got a testimony while he's talking?
Praise God. Anybody else have a testimony? Come on up here. Come on up here. Praise God. Listen to what Essie. Praise the Lord. Essie, I don't know. We might just use this time of night for testimonies.
Glory to God.
Amen.
Come on, Essie.
Praise God.
Glory to God.
Hate you, girl.
Amen. Whatever the Lord puts on your heart.
Praise God.
Glory to God.
Just don't take the whole service.
Wednesday morning, and I'm sitting there working, and we were talking about bitterness and unforgiveness and the diseases connected to it. Well, he said something about an article, so I Googled it. And that opened up this whole thing, and I spent like a couple hours that night just reading on it. It would blow your mind. Just Google diseases connected to bitterness. It's going to blow your mind. Well, I went to work, and it was just eating at me, and I was just thinking about it all day long. Well, the girl I work with come in, and I chit-chat with her all day, so I told her about it. While I'm talking to her, she looks at me, and I mean, when you're working, you're not like making eye contact constantly. So when I finally did look at her, she's about in tears, and I'm like, what's the matter? She goes, I told my husband, my ex-husband, that I hated him, and I wish he died. And I was like, what? And so we started talking about it, and right there in the middle of the deli, she hit her knees. She asked God to forgive her and accepted Christ. Right there in the middle of the deli.
Praise the Lord.
And that even before we even got done with work, she asked me if she could use her phone, and she called her ex-husband, and she asked him for forgiveness.
Yeah.
And that wouldn't have happened, because if we'd have done Wednesday night service, I don't go to work on Thursdays. I wouldn't have talked to her. She's off every Friday. And by Saturday, I probably would have forgot about it. So, thanks to Tuesday night.
Praise God. Now, that's being available for the Lord.
Amen.
Do we have any more testimonies? Linda, come on up here. Praise God.
Glory to God.
We're going to turn this into a testimony service.
Amen.
Amen.
I like testimony.
It's been, I think, a year and a half, 2 years this past. Yeah. I had started having problems, heaviness in my chest. So I went walking and I started having pain in my left arm, so I knew something wasn't right. So I went to the doctor, and of course when I told her about the pain and the numbness, immediately, you know, heart attack. So I did the nuclear stress test, and it came back, showed that there was possible blockage on the left side of the heart. I had three doctors look at it and told me this. So they sent me to a cardiologist, and I went to the cardiologist, him being the third doctor, and he said, you know, suspicious, there's blockage. So he set me up for a heart cath, and he immediately started me on medicine and gave me nitro and told me, you know, how to take it. Of course, I knew. So we were set up for that, and I was supposed to go on that Monday, but
Monday morning
for the heart cath. So I had started the church that night, and I didn't take the nitro with me, but I thought, well, I'm going to just take it because I hadn't used them. And I came, and I was sitting right there where Joe was sitting. And Carrie's sitting right over there, and I got hurt. Okay, this go away. It didn't go away, so I got up, and I went back, and it was the same thing. I took the nitro. And I came back, and I sat down, and I thought, okay. And the time went, you know, the time, and ooh, something ain't right. So I took another one. Carrie looks over at me, and I'm getting clammy, classic symptoms. And I'm asking, and Carrie said, "Mama, what's wrong?" I said, "My chest is hurting." So Brother Dan, I said something to Brother Dan.
That's when we had to say, "Time, we need to pray."
So right in the middle of everything, said, "Need to pray." And Brother Dan said, "Come on up here." I said, "I can't," because I was hurting. I knew something bad was wrong. So Brother Dennis gets back there, and he's standing in the front there and praying over me. And, you know, it's still hurting. And, you know, by this time, I'm fixing, this is fixing to be over with. I know I'm on my way out. So he got serious that time. He takes his coat off and slings it off. And, you know, let's get down to business. And he prayed for me. Continue, and the pain went away. Well, I knew you by taking the second nitro, if the pain's relieving, let's say it's your heart. So after that, it didn't hurt. Of course, the kids wouldn't have it me go home by myself, so they said, "Let's just go on up." We called the doctor. We went on up, kept me in the ER for, overnight for observation. No more pain, no nothing. So the next day, I went in for the heart cath. You know, I just knew it was all over. You know, I just had stents, my life, you know. I mean, you know, I've never had heart problems, and it scared me. It really scared me. So I went back and had that done, and when I came back out, the doctor had met with Adrian and Carrie, and they said, I hope my heart looks as good as your mama's does.
Amen.
There was no problem. I called them up, you know, just to be sure that wasn't what somebody get told. And they said, "No, ma'am, you have no heart problems. You don't need to come see us.
Glory to
you
God.
Don't need to take any medicine. You're free."
That's
it. I have not had one symptom since that night. Since
Amen.
And I know that God did it.
Yes.
I know that. He healed me.
Praise the Lord.
Back
Jesus is a healer.
Amen. Glory to God.
Amen. Praise God. Would you like to testify about your knee? No, it ain't. That's a miracle.
That's right. Amen.
Amen.
Okay, but well, praise the Lord.
Just small for God.
Come on, Sherry. Come on.
Praise God. Tell them what happened. How it happened.
Glory to God.
Hey, knee pain is, that's big.
Mm-hmm. It's a very natural one, is actually a better one. About my ankle. Anyway, I'm slipped on mashed potatoes at Jerry. I mean, at Barry's. Everybody knows that. As if I wasn't humiliated enough, you know, you slept on mashed potatoes. And it was a miracle right there because my mouth hit the concrete. And it didn't do anything to my mouth. But my knee had a big knot on it. It was bruised and I was having trouble walking. And James said that was the night that Brother James preached, and he prayed for my knee. And he felt he go through my knee when he did it, and he had a knot. And I was thinking about going to the doctor next week. When we got home, I had no knot, I had no bruise, and I hadn't had any pain since then. Hallelujah.
What about Mary Baxter?
Well, when Mary Baxter came, I was in a four-wheeler accident in 1998. And when I was in that four-wheeler accident, a blood clot got in my ankle. And at first they thought it was just a bruise. And I had a blood clot that was attached to my Achilles tendon. So Dennis had to take me and I had to have surgery. And they took out about 6 inches out of my ankle. Well, yeah, if that wasn't bad enough. Well, I got better and everything was going fine. Well, I had developed scar tissue. And I was having trouble walking. And you had gone back to the doctor. And they were going to have to do surgery all over again because the scar tissue was broken and it was hardening up again. Well, when I went into that service that night, I walked in, and I was late because I had to work, and I was a little late, and I had just gotten there. She was already on the platform speaking. She stopped, and she said, "There's somebody in here that has had tremendous pain in her ankle, and God wants to heal her right now." So I knew, y'all, I could barely walk. So I immediately, Dennis saw me, I went flying up there. And when she, because I was ready, I wanted to be gone so bad. And when she did it, it was like, just like heat, just like fire when she touched me. And it did not go away right then. But like 2 weeks later, it was just gone. And I told her it was so funny when I was in that car accident. I had a dot right there. It was from my sunglasses when the airbag hit me. And the doctor said to do plastic surgery that close to my eye would just be, you know, it'd be dangerous. And guess what? That was healed too. I got plenty of and she prayed for me. So that scar is home. So hallelujah.
Lord. Isn't the Lord wonderful?
Amen.
Amen. Praise God. Anybody else have a testimony while we're giving this out?
Glory to God.
Amen. Praise God. John, would you like to come on up here? John, would you like to talk about how the Lord blessed you with a job?
Yeah,
glory to God. And Sister Cook, you want to come and sit here and be next? I ain't putting on the spot. I'm sorry about that.
I might know a little more than just my job.
So. Yeah, go ahead.
Glory to God. Morning, you chose him.
Y'all know I got married 7 years ago. Levi's sins. Me and Missy got married. I moved down to Buckner. We went going to church in, and I grew up, and I'm not saying, but I grew up, my grandma took me every Sunday, every Wednesday, every Sunday night. I grew up in a Baptist church in Perth. And I got saved, I was baptized, I knew the Lord, you know. And I knew I was going to heaven. And I never had any doubts. Now some of the stuff I did, now looking back, I knew I wasn't going to heaven, knowing what I know now. But anyway, this pound, my mother-in-law started going to coming here. And Missy would come, and I'm like, Cindy, God. I ain't never heard of that. I don't know about that. I've been raised in Baptist. I don't know about all the hooting and hollering. I said, I don't know about that. So it started off just Missy, Miss Pam, and Dwight coming. And I'd stay home with the boys. And finally, Missy said, just go. I said, all right, I'll go. The rest is history, I love it. You know, I got here in the first couple of services, Miss Pam asked me, you know, how'd you like it? And I said, I like it, it's different, you know. I said, I like that he preaches the truth. You know? I said, it's a lot different than my Baptist church I've always grown in. But I said, I love it. But anyway, you know, I learned more stuff each Sunday I'd come. And it got to a point to where, I'm trying to think. It got to a point to where we was fixing to, it was getting close, let me rephrase that, for 6 or 7 years, five or six years, I always put in applications for the railroad. That was one of my dream jobs. I wanted to work for the railroad. Don't know why, but I did. But, and so I forgot about it. Well, my little brother got hired on about a year and a half before I did, and every now and then he'd text me, well, I never did. I put an application in that deal. Well, I put in an application and going here and listening to Brother Dennis and, you know, reading the Bible and stuff. I said, well, I got a claim to be mine. I went because I wanted to keep my job. Well, you pretty much make double the money on that. I know for a fact the good Lord is getting me ready for this next step. And it just so happened where we was living at the time, we had to move out. We didn't have to move. We wasn't forced to move out, but we had a situation with relatives where they needed back in the trailer we were renting next to Miss Pam. So we got to looking for a house. We found a house. Well, what a lot of people don't know, and I'm not ashamed to admit it, several years before that, I had to file bankruptcy. Well, me and Missy would think, oh man, you know, there's no way we're going to build a house. So we prayed about it. We found us a house for thousands under what it priced for. The actual sale, they had the house sold, and the day before they were supposed to close on it, it fell through. Well, we found, a friend of ours found it on Craigslist for us. But anyway, I went to the bank, and I told the lady my situation. And after the fact, she told me, somebody that filed bankruptcy that quick, I don't see how your credit score got that high that fast in order to buy this house. Right. And me and Missy already prayed about it. We said, we know what happened. The good Lord. So we closed on the house within 30 days. She said, I've never had a house close that fast in this situation. I said, well, you never met me. But anyway, we've been blessed with this house, with this job. I got to come back home back in June. I believe it was June. June or July, I got to come back home where I'm not working out of town. And like I said, it's a pay cut to come home. But since I've came home, I've not missed any money. Nothing. Everything's always worked out to where I've lost no money. Just spend the same money from when I was on the road, whether it be 4 or 5 hours overtime here, But what I'm saying is, if I know for a fact from experience, if you pray about it, just don't pray about it. You got to claim it and make it yours. And like I told everybody, and I tell Brother Dennis too, I put in for them applications all them years on the railroad. And somebody asked me now, how'd you get that job at the railroad? Were you that lucky? I said, no, I prayed about it.
Amen.
I claimed it. So
hallelujah.
Everybody that knows me knows that I prayed about it, and that's how I got the job on the railroad.
Yes, amen.
Amen.
Amen. God is good. God's amen. Doing a great work. John also, he was in Texas, I believe it was, but he used to deal with Copenhagen, didn't he?
Yeah, I forgot about that.
But anyway, he said one day, he said, how many years did you deal with Copenhagen?
13 years.
And you just quit it cold turkey.
I had a half a can left when we were sitting in the hotel room, and I said, and my roommate, he's a nice guy, but he don't talk much. And I got to tell him the devil that he was not going to claim me, have me over this.
Yeah.
And I said, I told him, I learned one of your services. I told the devil to go from me. Yeah. And not give me any temptations from this, for this dip. And I went in there and I poured a half a can of dip down the toilet and flushed it. Since then, I've never lost.
Hallelujah. Glory to God. Amen. God's doing a work. Sister Cook? Praise the Lord. Yes, yeah, Sister Cook. Come on up here. Praise the Lord. Glory to God. Let's give Jesus glory. Amen. Amen. Praise God.
Just tell them what to look.
Scare her, Daniel.
We're going to take that
mic. What Jesus has done?
Yes. I got married to Charlie when I was 21. And we didn't have babies for 15 years. And then one day I went to the Christian store and I found a book. And I started reading it. And then my faith started growing. And then I said, well, I'm going to pray when I finish the book. But then after a few chapters, I felt like praying already. So I started praying, and then I told God that I couldn't fast. You know, I couldn't leave food, I couldn't do without food, you know. So I was going to fast from all them soap operas I used to watch on TV. You know, like General Hospital and all that. I couldn't speak English, but I could understand. And then I prayed, and after a month and a half, I got pregnant with Gracie.
Yes.
Praise God. This is God's wonderful. Amen. Gracie's a miracle baby.
Yes.
Thank you, Sister Carrie. Yes. Praise the Lord. Sister Carrie, you have a testimony? Come on up here. Amen. Amen. Glory to God. Anybody else? Hunter, you want to give yours about your finger?
I can.
Yeah, you're next.
Do you want to? In other words, you get ready. Well, I just want to share that at the beginning of every year, I always write down prayer requests, specific prayer requests for that year in the back of my Bible for my friends and family. You know, so one day, not only me looking back over the years to build my faith and see where God has been faithful, but for my kids to be able to know all the prayers and how God has answered them and been faithful to us. So, got my list, and one of the things on my list this year is I want to see a supernatural miracle.
Yes. Glory
and God. So, I'm expecting it.
Hallelujah.
I'm expecting to see it. Now, is it going to be something that, you know, and it doesn't have to be with me, but I want to see it. I want to see it. And I'm expecting it. You know, just like John said, you've got to claim it and you've got to know it. And so I'm expecting. And, you know, that's what I say a lot of times up here. You come expecting. So I'm expecting to see that. But I want to share this too before I get into my testimony. But I was watching Kenneth Copeland, I think, last week. And, you know, supernatural miracles have been on my mind. And this is an example of one. It was, I think he said, a pastor in Africa, kind of a hostile area of Africa, but the lower portion in the elbow, he got shot. And so he said that what they did, and he knew this guy, he said what they did is like a hip replacement, they did an elbow replacement. And he said they did the elbow replacement and I guess got him a limb, you know, so he could function, but he said that it was excruciating pain. Just tremendous pain all day long. It hurt him and it hurt him. And he went on, you know, preaching, doing the Lord's work, but said that he was in prayer one night and said that he heard God say, I'm going to do something for you. That's all he heard God say. He woke up the next morning, and Kenneth Copeland had a picture of this, and so I saw it on TV. But he woke up the next morning and he looked, and the elbow replacement was laying between his body and his arm. It had supernaturally, during the night, been removed. There was no blood anywhere. It had been supernaturally removed and was laying in his bed with him. And to show the picture of it, it was like, you know, the metal thing, and it was like a spike that they had put into the bone, and he said his bone had to grow and wrap around it. They even, you know, he took it to his doctor and they even did some testing on it. It was his bone. And guess what was there? A new elbow.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Glory to God. Glory.
And so for some people, they're thinking, there's no way. But I know. He made us. He made everything in our body. Why can he not do that? But our minds, you know, we step out of seeing by faith and we're seeing in the natural, and we're thinking there's no way. That's what I want to see. That's what I'm expecting to see, and that's what he wants us to desire to see. But nevertheless, I know a lot of you probably heard it before, and I'll share it real quick without going into too many details, but I guess I was about 24-ish, and I wear contacts. I can't see very well without them. But I just went, I had to go every year to get my prescription renewed, so I'd be bopped in there and sit down, and this optometrist started looking at my eyes, and I noticed she just kept taking her time and kept looking at this one eye, and she'd go get another little apparatus, you know, those little things, and she'd do this and just kept looking. After about 10 minutes, I said, what's going on? What's taking so long? And she told me, she said, well, she said, I don't really know how to tell you this, but she said, there's swelling in your optic nerve. What they did, I sleep in my contacts. So, y'all know, most times you're supposed to take them out every night. Like, I'll go a month or 2 months and not take them out and not change them. And so I said, oh, I know what that is. I just sleep in my contacts. It's probably done caught up with me, you know. And she's like, no. And you could just tell it was heavy on her. She didn't tell me, but she said, well, you don't understand. She said, this is not something that's just like, you know. She said, it's pretty serious. And I said, okay. And you need an antibiotic or something? And she said, no. She said, for your optic nerve to be swollen, it means there's something pressing on the other side of the optic nerve, like a tumor. And so at this point, I'm still thinking, no. you know, it's just not set in. But anyway, long story short, I think when it really set in was when she told me that I had an appointment to go see a neuro-ophthalmologist, which they specialize in brain and the eye. And I think there's two of them. At that time, there was two in the state of Mississippi. And it was going to be 2 months out, and I was going to have to go to the coast. And when they told me that, I'm thinking, whoa, you know, this is pretty serious. So Brandon was at work, and I've always been the type, when Brandon's away, it don't matter if the house is torn down. I don't burden him with that at work, you know. And so I did not want to tell him that. And so Brandon comes home, and long story short, I ended up finding out that there was another one at UMC, and I got a sooner day because I got to thinking, this is not something I need to wait 2 months. If it is a tumor pressing them off, you know, I don't need to wait, you know, 2 months to go see this guy. So they pulled some strings. I had an appointment, but Brandon came home. And Abigail was a baby. So we go walking on some of our land up by the cemetery up there. Me and him went walking. We were strolling Abigail. When we got up there, I told him. I said, I just want to let you know. And I kind of laid everything out to him. And John Brandon was raised Southern Baptist, and so I brought him on over to the other side. But nevertheless, you know, therefore, while Brandon really didn't pray out loud, you know, they just always prayed for themselves, and it made him more uncomfortable. And so I was sharing with him, and he had been, you know, Pentecostal for several years there. But you know, I will never forget it. We were up on that hill, and I told him about it, and he said, well, stop right now, stop. And so I stopped, and he said, I want to pray for you. And I said, okay. And he said, do you believe that God can heal you right now? And I said, yeah, I believe God can heal me. So at this time, you know, nothing's been confirmed other than she said it's swollen and there's something there because it's very swollen. And so Brandon put his arms around me and he prayed. And, you know, it seemed like the longest prayer I think I've ever heard Brandon say. You know, but it was beautiful when we got done. He said, you believe you just got your healing? And I said, yeah, I do. He said, no, do you really believe that God just healed you? And I said, I believe it. So we started walking down the hill from the cemetery, and I started feeling a numbing and tingling sensation. You know when your arm goes to sleep or your leg? About the size of a quarter right here. And it went on for several minutes, because at first I thought, I'm just imagining that, but it just kept on for several minutes. And I told him, I said, I know I got my healing. I said, I can feel it right now. I know. So anyway, I go to a neuro-ophthalmologist in Hattiesburg, and I'm claiming my healing now at this point. I'm healed. But I've got the appointment, kind of like mom. I want to go through, you know, take care of what I got to take. So we go down there, and they wanted to do a spinal tap on me to see how much pressure was being put on my brain. And so in order to do that, they have to put an IV in. And I don't do well with needles and IVs. And so we get back there, and just as they go to put that needle in, I pass that moment. Well, when I wake up, I've got nurses everywhere, and they tell me, you've just had a seizure. Like, don't move. We've got the doctor coming. We're not doing the spinal tap, everything. You just had a seizure. And all I can remember was like just coming to and just all kind of thoughts just flickering through my mind and thinking. I remember thinking, I said, what am I doing? What am I thinking? What's going on? And I woke up. And I said, no, I didn't have a seizure. I passed out. I said, because I've had veins to blow and it's so painful with my bony hands. And I said, I just passed out. No, it was a seizure. And the doctor wants you to come to his office. And Mom and Brandon was there. So we left there and went to the doctor's office. And from there at the doctor's office, we waited how long? A couple hours. And I slept the whole time. I would go to sleep. I would wake up. I would go back to sleep. And Mom, being a nurse, she works with kids that have seizures every day. And she said, she said, you act like you've had a seizure. She said, because when you have a seizure, you know, your body just tenses up so that you're exhausted. And she was concerned, you know, from a mom's standpoint. But I was still just standing firm. Nope, I just passed out. So anyway, I went back there and I talked to this doctor. And he asked me all these signs and symptoms. And I told him, no, not having headaches, not having anything like that. And he said, well, you're not going to do the spinal tap because you had a seizure and we're not going to put you through that. So they sent me to another guy at university. And what his job was to put ink, some kind of dye in my vein, so they could go. And it, what it did is it made all my little veins in my eyes glow. It was like a neon orange. So he could just really see all the detail stuff. So he got up there, and he was an Asian doctor. And they looked at everything, and I go back there in his office, and he said, who sent you to me? And I told him the doctor's name, and he said, yeah, I know her. And he said, why'd she send you up here? And I said, well, she said that I had optic nerve swelling and that blah, 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 blah. And he said, well, I don't see any optic nerve swelling. And I said, I know. That was my response to him. Mom was there, she can tell you. I said, I know, there's not anything. And he said, but you don't understand. He said, this kind of swelling don't just happen and go away. He said, if there's swelling, there's something there. And I said, I know, but God, you know, I believe that my God healed me. And he said, no, you don't understand. He was just like, he was confused. What, he was like, you don't understand. Finally, he said, let me break it to you. He said, if I was to go out on the street and get a white female your age, perfectly healthy eyes, and bring her in here and look at her eyes, he said, that would be your eyes. They are perfectly healthy. And I said, I know.
Praise God.
But anyway, though, but he told me from a medical standpoint, he said, there's no way that there could have been swelling and it just went down because that doesn't happen. So anyway, I knew I had my healing, but then there came the seizure. The devil tried to deliver that to me. No, here it is. You do have a brain tumor because now you're having seizures. And I rebuked it, and I said no. Well, after this, I remember going back to work. I worked at that time, and I was in our fax room, and I was in the middle of faxing, and it was like, I wouldn't really say it was a vision, but all of a sudden, out of nowhere, a few weeks, months later, it was like I saw myself, you know, no hair, just pale, knowing that I had cancer and was going through chemo. And just for a second, I remember just feeling despair, like, you know, Abigail was a little baby and Jackson was 3 or 4 years old, and I remember just for a split second, just like, what are they going to do about me? And all of a sudden, I snapped out of it, and I went to rebuking the devil, and I said, I am healed by his stripes. I was healed. I am healed. And I rebuked it, but he tried to bring it back. And there's been times since then that I'll have a sharp pain, or I'll have a headache, or I will have a pain in that area. And I have to say, devil, I'm not taking it. I have been healed. You know why? And I had to remind the devil, because I really got loud that day at the office. And I think some people down the hall heard me, but that's okay. But I said, you know what? I've got too much work to do. I was in my early 20s, and I said, I'm just getting started. I've got too much to do for the kingdom. I'm not going anywhere, devil. I know you're trying to get me, but I know that he healed me. But another thing that I want to leave you with tonight is God has always, always been faithful.
Amen.
You know, when you're in the storm, you don't really realize why you're there or what the outcome is going to be. But how beautiful it is to be on the mountaintop and to look back and to see where you were in the valley, and that he was there all the time.
Amen.
And that he made a way. But you know what? His way is perfect.
Amen.
Even if it takes longer, just to wait on him, because he does not make mistakes. He is perfect.
Yes, he is.
And so Brother Dennis has just always asked you to have a testimony. And you know, the biggest thing that I can say is my God is faithful.
Yes.
Amen.
If you'll be faithful to him, he'll be faithful to you.
Hallelujah. Praise God. Hunter Young, you come up here. I tell you, God is an awesome God.
Amen.
Yes, and he loves his people. Amen. And whether it's healing the body or giving a blessing to finances or giving you a job or giving you strength or joy or whatever it might be, or peace of mind, God wants you at peace, spirit, soul, and body.
Yes, amen.
Amen, praise God. God doesn't want his creation. Listen, he is the creator. We are the creation. He loves his creation. Amen.
Yes.
Praise God.
In the past, I've been known to be prone to cuts. Bust my head, cut my fingers and hands. I don't work safe, don't wear gloves. Long story short, I was doing a trade, a four-wheeler for a truck, big truck. I was excited. It's one of those little freak moments. How many times you can trade a four wheeler for a truck? And I better get the trailer and his lawnmower was on the previous, about a week or so ago. I backed up to it, hopped out. I always grab the trailer and throw it up on the truck. I mean, what, Ed? A little 4x8, a little lawnmower on. I grabbed it, pulled it, and it was about yay far out of here. And it was sitting on a cylinder block. It rolled back in the yard, squished my finger off. It didn't hurt. I mean, I didn't feel no pain. I pulled my hand up and just sprayed blood, my bones hanging out. I was, oh my gosh. Took my shirt off, ran in the house. I don't even remember turning the truck. I don't remember doing nothing. I just remember taking my shirt off, squeezing so hard that I ripped a piece of the skin off. It was dead when we got to the hospital. Mom rushed me down to Mendenhall. What hurt the worst when they stuck that needle in my finger. Yeah. That needle, woo. I'm not even lying, that hurts. Anyway, they took me to, where did they take me, Amy? I don't even remember.
UMC.
Okay, UMC.
I took you to UMC.
She drove me. Yeah, I didn't want to ride down. Got there, they stuck another needle in my finger. I passed out. I cried, man, it hurt. You see your bone, you'll face
it. It was considered
an
open fracture.
Yeah, it was broke all the way. I mean, it was broke in so many places. They put me in a room. They said, tomorrow we're going to come get you. We've done some x-rays and stuff like this, and we're going to cut the first part of your distal off. You got distals in your fingers. I didn't know that until this happened. And they said, we're going to cut it off, and you ain't going to have no nail. No, I said, I was getting all emotional. I was like, no, I can't get it.
They told you that you had
I couldn't get it in my mind that I was going to have 10 fingers and 9 nails.
I know.
I didn't cut it. You know, I was sitting in that bed, and Amy said I was so messed up on medicine. They had me, you know, I was talking to the lady that was bringing the trash can. I don't remember.
My story.
Yeah, I told everybody what happened. Brother Dennis come and prayed for me. I had a dead piece of skin. The doctor, just before Brother Dennis came, he laid it up on my finger. He said, it's dead. It's completely dead. It was white. You know, dead skin.
They said that when they unwrapped it, that the dead skin was white.
Let me tell the story.
Hey, you were on the medicine, Hunter. She's got the real thing.
You weren't on the medicine.
I still remember that. And the doctor told me, he said, we're going to wrap it up. We're just going to put it on there. Maybe, you know, it'll start growing back. And I said, maybe so. And he wrapped it up. And he said, you can eat at 12 o'clock. I think you ran down to Chick-fil-A. I had Chick-fil-A at 12 o'clock. After that, I couldn't have nothing until 6, after 6:30 that next day, that night. He come in there with some glasses. These glasses. Wow, they had like zoom and binoculars on there. They had regular glasses. He unwrapped that before that. Now, Brother Dennis had come and prayed for me for about 3 hours. And that man unwrapped that finger. And he said, well, we got some good news and bad news. He said, we come to get you to cut your finger off, and we're going to sew it up, and it's going to be square. He said, but he had his glasses on. I was staring at him. It was pretty. And I said, well, tell me the good news first. He said, we ain't taking you to surgery. He said, I don't have insurance. And he said, your insurance is not going to let you go into surgery. But that piece of dead skin has started growing back. He said, you're going to go home, take care of yourself. I think I spent 4 or 5 weeks. Every day, it was red, green, blue on me, every color rainbow. Bloody, every day. That piece of dead skin, it was dead, completely dead. That saved me from having to have a surgery and cut my finger off. Because it grew back my finger.
Yes. Hallelujah.
I still can feel the bone. The bone's so close to the skin. But I have no pain. They said that I would never be able to feel. It'd be hard to touch.
They said you'd never have a fingernail.
Told me I'd never be able to bend it. They told me I'd never be able to roll it. They told me I'd never have a nail. And Brother Dennis came and we prayed over it. And I think if Brother Dennis wouldn't have come, they probably would have had to cut my finger out. You know? Because, I don't know, it was crazy how it happened. I've always been prone. High school, way back in preschool, kickball, I put 10 staples in my head playing kickball. I've always been cutting stuff. But I had just got into this church when it happened. That was 2012. No, 13. Beginning of 13. Yeah, I can't hear. I don't care.
Praise God.
But long story short, that's healing from the Lord, from my finger.
Yes.
I don't care what nobody says. That was dead skin. Like, it was the color of this piece of paper, white. It does not hurt. No pain, no nothing. Then I went one time to check up on him. After that doctor told me I'd never be able to bend it or have a nail, I said, well, I ain't going back. I don't need him. And we just took care of it and bandaged it and had a big old rash in my finger for like 6 weeks. Couldn't do anything but sit at the house. It's something but the Lord that blessed my finger. It's you don't know, your finger don't mean much to you until you cut it off. Think about having 9 fingers and 9 nails, 10 fingers. That's it again. No, I kept looking now. No, that ain't happened. It's fully there, the same length as this one. It's just curved under here. Looks weird, but it's me now.
Amen.
Glory to God. Amen. A doctor one time told you had a skin disease, right?
Yeah.
And you couldn't.
Before I met you, I had a rash. It's like I broke out or something. Mm-hmm. And I went to the dermatologist, and he started naming all this, and it was the worst kind of eczema he'd ever seen. I could never be in the sun. And he told me I was sick. I'm like, I don't have that. I have some rash. I'm going to take Benadryl. I don't have that.
So you didn't claim it from the doctor.
And I wouldn't say that.
You didn't agree with it.
I didn't accept it.
Yeah. Sister Tracy, praise God. I believe we have Tracy and Brother James. Anybody else?
Praise God. Amen.
I have a testimony where whenever I was first born, I was considered as a blue baby. My lips and fingers and stuff were blue. And I had a transposition of the great artery. They didn't think that I was good. They did a lot of surgeries on me. From the time I was born up until I was 25. The doctors told my mom and them to enjoy me, that they didn't know how long that I would be around. Mom and them prayed, of course, and I don't think the Lord wanted me. I don't know about how to do this. But I grew up, I had all kind of shunts, spontaneous repairs, heart calves. They had to blow my lungs up to get me breathing, to suck my bottle and stuff like that. I was 6 years old. I had my first upper heart surgery. They turned me pink. I was happy to be pink. From there on out, I was doing real good. They still kept telling my mom and them that they didn't know how long I lived. They didn't expect me to be a teenager because my heart would play out. And I'm still kicking, of course. But I got, like I said, 6 years old. I had open heart surgery that turned me pink. Then I kept on with my checkups and everything. And I was still doing good. And the doctors were surprised. And then whenever I turned 13 years old, I had to have a pacemaker implanted because whenever I slept at night, my heart would drop so low that I could have died in my sleep and nobody would have knew anything about it. So I had the pacemaker going, it done good. It lasted me for 13 years. I was 25 years old and I had another surgery have it replaced. And then, of course, after I grew up, I got married and all that, and had kids. Doctors always told my mom, do not let her get pregnant, she could die. Her heart couldn't handle it. There ain't no way she can do it. Well, I turned 30. But before I turned 30, I was 29. I just turned 29. I was sitting at home reading the Bible, and I had called my heart doctor and everything, and I talked to him, and I said, I want a family. Is there anything, like, they got all kind of new technologies and stuff that would help people like me and stuff to have children and stuff? He told me, he says, no. He said, the answer is always no, Tracy. He said, your heart's not going to be able to take it. He said, you're lucky yourself to be alive. He said, let's not push it. I said, okay. So I sat down at the table and I was crying. And I said, God, I don't know what else to do. I said, I've asked the doctors, I've asked all the questions I know to ask. And he said, clearly, you're asking the wrong one. And I said, okay, God. So from then on, I started praying. And I said, God, I want your will to be done in my life. I said, it's not what the doctors say, it's what you say. You've kept me alive this long. So I started praying and everything. Well, a year later, I turned 30. I ended up pregnant. Well, my doctors, of course, was freaking out. They were saying that I wasn't going to live, that my heart was going to play out. They wanted me to take medicine to abort the baby. And I told them no. I said, because as soon as I found out I was pregnant, there was a peace that came over me. And I knew that God had this. Amen. I mean, I was not scared. I had no fear at all. I cried because I was scared about what I did. But, I don't think I even told him. I think I might really do. So I was kind of scared for them, but I knew. And I went to the doctor and I started getting everything for my baby and everything. And that woman, she was like, I don't think this is going to work. I said, well, I know it is. I said, I just know it is. They said, okay, we're going to try this. Every time I went to the heart doctor, he would do an echo and an EKG on me. And that would show the signs of my heart or rhythm. He'd run a pacemaker test on me to see if there was any change. Because with a pacemaker, you can go back, like monthly, to see what your heart has done and what it has not done. All the time I was pregnant, I never got sick. I never had any type of illnesses or anything. My heart never skipped a beat. My heart never changed. It never speed up or slow down. It never failed to work for me. It worked as if I wasn't even pregnant at all. And whenever I went to have Michaela, I was scared that my blood pressure would raise or during C-section or whatever. My heart would stop or whatever. And I told myself, I'm scared. I said, let's do this. But, I mean, even having labor pains, my mama was standing there. I had one labor pain that hurt me the most, and that was whenever I knew it was time for her to come. Other than that, I slept most of the time through the whole labor pains. They had me up on my side with blankets and stuff rolled behind my back, because they didn't want me on my back. They want me on my side. But that one pain hit me, and I looked at my mama, and my mama said, it's time. I rolled back into the place where we're doing a C-section and everything. I never felt the epidural. Everybody said they hurt. I never felt it. They laid me down. They had both my arms strapped like this. And they cut me open, and I heard her crying. I was crying. And my blood pressure and my heart rate never went up, never dropped. My blood pressure stayed level. Everything through the whole entire thing stayed the exact same. So about 2 months ago, I went to see my heart doctor. He also ran an EKG and an echo and all that on me again. And he said, I don't know how in the world you did it. He said, but it's like you were never pregnant. I said, it wasn't me. I said, I told y'all, my God is awesome.
Yeah.
I said, every time he called me.
He is a miracle worker, isn't he?
Yes.
Amen?
Amen.
Praise God. Brother James, does anybody else have a testimony after Brother James? Praise God. Well, if you did, it'll be have to be some other time.
About all the good news that God's still on the throne, still large and in charge.
Amen.
Praise God.
What came to my mind, I could stand here all night and tell you about things I've experienced from the time I was a young lad until now, of miracles that can't be explained by human science. Scientists couldn't explain it. They just froze. You know, we don't know what happened, but we know that God intervened.
Amen.
One Sunday morning, we were talking, a few of us were talking inside the sanctuary, fellowshipping one another, and Brother Val rattled, and he come through the door, and just right out of my spirit, I said, Brother Val, I said, God's going to heal those knees today. He'd already had surgery set up that coming Wednesday. And I didn't have time to think about what I was going to say. It just came out, you know. Brother Val, God's going to heal those knees. You know, I'll get thankful, you know, after it's over. Why did you say that? You know, why did you say that? Well, all during service, you know, it just kept rolling over in my mind, you know. God's going to heal his knees. So through the entire service, you know, this was my station over here on this side. Brother Val was sit on the opposite side. We had a sister over here, Sister Charlotte back in the corner. And just as he went to close out the service, and I'm saying, well, must have missed it. About that time, the lady in the back says, God's telling me that there's someone here that's got a knee problem. You know, Brother Val, he's almost turning somersaults over there, you know, yeah. So we had formed a circle up in front of the pulpit in what we call the hot seat area. We bring them up here in front, sit them down in the hot seat, pray for them. And he never had his knees operated on. God took those old knees that they were going to replace each one of them one at a time, you know, whether they put the plutonium or whatever it is that they put in you now. But anyway, he lived 5 or 6 more years after, you know, and God took him on. He's in glory land walking those streets and shouting right now. But God is still on the throne. He can still do these things. All we have to do is believe.
Amen.
That we receive.
Amen.
Don't listen to your thoughts like Brother Dennis said. You know, the devil will get into your mind. He can't get into your soul. You believe, you receive, and stand on it. When you've done all, stand. You know, so I've got my healing, devil. You just might as well go on, leave me alone. Just like you would. It's like a little dog gets the best of the way. Get him out of here! Don't just tell him to go. He's got to go. The Bible backs it up. So, Brother Val, he was a good Christian man, and we've had some good Holy Ghost meetings together. Boy, had some good times in the Lord. He's gone on to be with Jesus now, but God took care of those knees. And that's one of the things too that I'd like to point out, that God brings you through these things and you think about how it operated. See, it came up to the end of the service, and I'm getting, you know, human nature says, well, maybe I missed it, or I don't even know why I told you. You know, it just came out. I said, Brother Val, God's going to heal your knees today. You know, to the end of the service. And just before closing out service with prayer, this sister in the back, she obeyed God, the Holy Spirit. She said, there's someone in here God gave her a word of knowledge. There's someone in here that's got problems with their knees. Well, had she not done that, Brother Val wouldn't have gotten his healing. So it's very important that we stay in tune, we tune into that love station. You know, they on the AM dial. You know, you put your bumper right up against the tower. If you're on AM, you ain't going to pick up the love channel. Just keep tuned in, you know. So that's where we need to be, you know. And you learn these things as you experience them. You know, God will bring back into your remembrance. The Holy Ghost brings back to your remembrance these things. Well, I know what's fixing to happen right now. I saw this happen before. I know God's going to take care of this. Well, you got this. Come on, devil. Come on, devil, get you some. We ain't scared of you. Amen. You know? And he's got to go. You know, he can't hang around a bunch of Holy Ghost filled, right, jumping up, down, hand clamping, foot stomping Christians. You know, he got to go. So I'll leave y'all with that. I could stand up here all night. Yeah.
Praise God.
Thank you.
Praise God. Wonder. Anybody else? Maybe room for one more, and that's it. Is there anybody else who want to testify?
Let Miss Arlene testify.
Let Miss Arlene testify.
I want to tell you about it.
Yeah, Emma. I don't have anything.
It's not spectacular what God does for me. There's nothing spectacular about it. It's just God. He just does.
Amen.
But I want to tell you about how God touches the sinner, when I don't even know that God's touching the sinner.
That's right.
I was 18 years old. I was 5 months pregnant. And for those of y'all that know what a Ford Courier is, it's a little small rat trap of a vehicle. It looks like it's made out of tin foil.
A
rat trap. A death trap's what it is. My first husband and I had one. And I was driving it. I was going from a little town called Collins to a town that's even smaller called Dermot in Arkansas. That's where my doctor was. The doctor delivered me. I was going to have him deliver my first child. I was on the back road. Y'all know what a rug board is on the back gravel road? I hit that thing. Didn't think I was going very fast, about 40 miles an hour on the gravel road. Nothing big. That Ford Courier hit a stump. And it flipped. And it traveled probably 10 to 20 yards. And it stopped just about a foot away from a ravine. Upside down on the top. And being a country girl, I had a pistol in there with me and it was loaded. There was no safety on it, but it never went off. I rolled the window down and I climbed through the window of a Ford Courier, upside down, 5 months pregnant. Now put that picture in your mind. I'm on a back road where there's no phones, there's no houses, there's nobody. And I took David down some of those roads and got him lost within the first 10 minutes. That's how it worked out for us. I got out and I stood against the side of that truck and I stood there and waited. And some people that knew my family stopped and picked me up and took me to my mom's house. Well, I went on to the house, went on to the doctor, to the emergency room. I didn't have a scratch on me, not one bruise, nothing. A few years later, now, in all this, I knew God. I'd been baptized when I was 15 in the Southern Country Baptist Church, but I wasn't allowed to go to church much. So I didn't know that much about God. I was back on that country road again, this time in S10. Still a little death trap. I had two girls with me. I was probably 20 years old. My youngest one was less than a year old. And at that time, you didn't have car seats. You didn't have to be buckled up. That's when mamas held out their arms and held out the babies. Hold on.
That's right.
Hold up.
Tracy went pop.
Yeah. Little baby didn't go nowhere.
gravel road going opposite direction this time, and I get another rub board. This time I landed that vehicle between two trees. I didn't hit the trees. There was about 6 inches on each side. I could not open either truck door. But because it hit one and bounced over to the other, the back windshield was out, so I took my girls and I put them out that back window. Now, y'all don't know me, but I've been overweight all my life. You try putting this beauty. That's the work right there. That's the work. And I want to say all this to show you that God brought me through all that. I never had a scratch. My kids never had a scratch. I should have been dead, and they should have been dead. We should have hit those trees head on. God saved me, filled me with the Holy Ghost, and sanctified me 6 years later.
Hallelujah.
And I'm still serving him to this day.
He's a miracle worker.
Amen.
Dennis, can I say something?
Sure.
I had forgotten about this testimony. This is something that happened on February 6th. And your testimony, I don't know if y'all know, Dylan was in an accident on Gunner Road on February 6th. January 6th. On Gunner Road. Gunner Road has had a lot of people have been killed on Gunner Road. It's called Snake Road, is what it's called in Rankin County. Well, the officer, Dylan texted me, I didn't answer the phone. He texted me and I was in the shower. And he said, Mom, you know, I'm trying to get you. I've been in a horrible accident. And I couldn't get him. I called Dennis. Have you heard from Dylan? He said, no, he called, but, you know, I was busy. So, you know, I didn't know what to do. You know, I didn't know where he was. He was in a horrible accident. So I texted my boss and said, listen, Dylan's been in an accident. I'm not going to be late. So I just sit down in the chair in my room and I started crying. I said, no, God is in control. I'm not going to cry. He's alive. He's fine. If he's able to text, he's able to call 911. He's fine. So, you know, a few minutes later, he called me and said, the officer wants to talk to you. And I said, oh, is he okay? And he said, ma'am, it is miraculous. If y'all see that picture, he said, I cannot believe these boys. He said, Dylan has a scratch on his arm. Other boy's fine. Dylan has a scratch. Fine. I've looked at him. He said, it's miraculous. He said, they hit that bridge and they went boom, boom. He said, he might have hit it twice. He said, he fell asleep. And he was probably speeding and he hit that bridge. Boom, boom, boom. Cars totaled, but both boys and fine. Nothing wrong with them. God is in control. The night before, he knew something. He was praying in the spirit. He said, I don't know who I'm praying for, but I am intervening and I am praying for somebody. And God gave him that the night before. And Lord is alive. And we believe he's going to be saved.
Thank God he's our fortress.
Yes.
Anybody else?
Glory to God.
Before we go, let it be time for one more. Robert, are you making to get up here?
You behind that microphone?
Praise God. You ready to get behind this microphone? Praise God. It looks like she is. I like messing with Robbie. Yeah. Praise God. Praise the Lord. Well, the Lord is good, isn't he?
Amen.
We can sit here. I can sit here and tell you some testimonies, and I know you could too, and many of you. I mean, Essie didn't even share all of hers, and Sherry didn't share all of hers, and I know you didn't share all yours. We'd be here from this time next week. Amen?
Amen.
But God is an awesome God.
Amen.
Amen. I know Dwight had one. He was in an automobile accident one time. It was a miracle. He lived that through that one. So we all have testimonies that we could share. Amen. But and we give all the glory to our God.
Yes.
Amen. Yeah.
But before we go, we want to pray for Peggy Harrington and Donald Holston. And I'm going to pray, and I just want you to be in agreement with this. Amen.
J.J. Loud.
J.J. Loud? Mm-hmm. Okay, what was wrong with him?
He's the one that Miss Diane told you about.
Oh, yeah. Okay. Praise God. Father, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, we come before you. Lord, we thank you that you said in your word, where two or three are gathered together, in my name, there am I in the midst of them. Father, we just got through hearing about your power. Hallelujah. Power to answer prayer. power to heal. And Lord, our first testimony tonight was about hearing heaven, a church from heaven, come to the earth. And later it was a dog pound. God, you want to heal so bad. You want to perform so desperately. But there's walls that keep you from operating. Lord, we love you. We love the brethren. Hallelujah. We love our enemies. We forgive. And Father, I thank you that we are positioning ourselves for the blessings of God. And Father, we just heard these powerful testimonies. Father, you are our healer. Lord Jesus, thank you for being our healer. And devil, I bind you and break your power. Go in Jesus' name. And Father, I speak the word to Donald Holston in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Father, I ask you to heal his ankle, around his foot, in the name of Jesus. I speak life to his skin, in the name of Jesus. I speak life to his body, to his tissues, in Jesus' name. I speak life to you, Donald Holston, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Skin, tissues, muscles, ligaments, be healed. In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ of Nazareth, the Messiah, the King of Kings and Lord of Lords, I speak life to your limb in Jesus' name. Thank you, Father, for healing in the name of Jesus. Thank you, Father, in Jesus' name. Donald Holston, thank you, Lord, for healing his skin, his muscles, his tissues, his ligaments. Thank you, Father. It is written, by whose stripes ye were healed. It is written, himself took our infirmities and bare our sicknesses. It is written, Christ hath redeemed us from the curse of the law. Thank you, Father, in Jesus' name for Donald Holston's healing. Hallelujah. How many believe it?
Amen.
I believe it. Don't doubt it, but believe the word. In Jesus' name. And Father, we pray for Peggy Harrington in the name of Jesus. Lord, we speak the word. We send the word in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ to Peggy Harrington. Lord, we ask you to heal her kidneys in Jesus' name. Devil, I bind you and break your power. Take your hands off of her kidneys. I bind you and break your power. Infection, go! In Jesus' name. Kidneys, be healed in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Thank you, Father, for healing in Peggy Harrington's kidneys. In Jesus' name, I plead the blood of Jesus over her kidneys and plead the blood of Jesus over Donald Holston's leg, ankle, foot. In Jesus' name. Thank you, Father, for strong, healthy kidneys in Peggy Harrington's body. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. On this Sunday night, Lord, we thank you that you do hear and you have heard, and we thank you for their healing. In Jesus' name. And Lord, J.J. Loud, thank you, Father, in the name of Jesus for touching him from the top of his head all the way down to the soles of his feet and out of his fingers. In the name of Jesus. Lord, I speak life. I speak life in the body of J.J. Loud in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Body, be healed.
Yes, Lord.
In Jesus' name. Thank you, Lord. There's no distance in the Spirit. I thank you, Father, in Jesus' name for touching him. I thank you in Jesus' name for touching Donald. I thank you in Jesus' name for touching Peggy. Thank you, Lord, for their healing in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. And Father, I thank you for the flock. I thank you for the congregation. I speak blessings into each and every person under the sound of my voice. In Jesus' name, I speak blessings. And Lord, I prophesy over them in the name of Jesus that 2016 will be a year of increase in the Spirit. In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, more revelation. Amen. More of God. Jesus said, blessed are those that hunger and thirst after righteousness, for they shall be filled.
Amen.
Thank you, Father, in Jesus' name. More increase in the Spirit, increase in the gifts, increase in healings, increase in the anointing, in the name of Jesus. Thank you, Father, for revelation knowledge, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Thank you for dreams, visions, translations, signs, wonders. Thank you, Father. We believe and expect them among us in the name of Jesus. Thank you, Father, for experiences in line with the Word of God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Father, that the supernatural is with us.
Amen.
In Jesus' name. And Lord, I thank you for divine guidance even by angels.
Yes.
In the name of Jesus. Thank you, Father, we're the head and not the tail. We're above and not beneath. We are the people of the living God.
Amen.
And Father, I thank you that we are a supernatural bunch. We are a supernatural people because we have faith and believe in a supernatural God. Thank you, Father, in Jesus' name. And everybody said,
amen.
Amen. Hallelujah.
Hey, don't go seeking for it.
Glory,
praise God. It's God. See, Jesus said, seek and you shall find.
Amen.
Be careful you don't seek the wrong thing. That works on the good just as well as the that works both ways. You know, a lot of times we think of that only one facet. If you seek good, you get good. But what about if you seek bad? You keep seeking bad, guess what you're going to get? Bad. Amen. Seek and you shall find. Well, that don't only mean good things. That means bad things too. Amen. I've laid hands on people in the name of Jesus, and they might have went to going back seeking their symptoms. Don't do that.
Right.
You're calling them back. And your inward man's trying to bring them back. Don't go seeking those symptoms again. Start seeking Jesus. No,
yeah.
Oh, Jesus, I've got the healing. Amen. Be careful with that because that is a law. Seek and you shall find. We're seeking the blessings of God, not what we were delivered from.
Amen.
Are you hearing me?
Glory to God.
And a lot of people has left here after prayer, and they don't know. That's why we're here. We're here to teach.
Yeah.
And they leave, they're starting to find those symptoms. Whether those symptoms are gone or not, you're seeking your healing, not them.
Yeah.
Amen. Amen. Praise God. Anybody else? Is that it? How many of us to believe that Donald and JJ and Peggy is the healed?
Amen.
Yes. Yes.
Amen. Amen. Amen.
Praise God.
Praise God.
My Cecilia is texting me. She's doing better. They're keeping her overnight for observation and antibiotics, but she's already doing better.
Amen.
Praise God. Amen. We sent the word in the name of Jesus.
Yes.
Let's all stand. Hallelujah.
Yes.
Glory to God. I'll say it, you say it. It is written.
It is written.
God has not given me,
God has not given me
a spirit of fear.
A spirit of fear.
But of power.
But of power.
And of love.
And of love.
And of a sound mind.
And of a sound mind.
I'm an overcomer.
I'm an overcomer.
I overcome devils.
I overcome devils.
I overcome circumstances.
I overcome
life's tests.
I overcome life's tests.
I'm an overcomer.
In Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Praise God.